depending on how the events take place.
All right, let's start off with our discussion on the third quarter earnings season, which officially kickstarts with Infosys on the 10th. But what's the underlying theme? Do we see corporate earnings perhaps picking up, or is this going to be another setback as far as quarterly earnings are concerned? And which sectors would do well as far as earnings? Starting with the Infosys on the 10th and IndusInd Bank, again, we would start to see numbers coming in thick and fast, and over the next 1 month, numbers will flow in, which will give us a sense as to how corporate India has managed to withstand the onslaught that was thrown at it over the last quarter as far as the economic glut is concerned. To get more perspective, Prasad Koparkar, Senior Director at CRISIL Research, is with us right now from Mumbai. Prasad, great having you with us. I read the report that you put out talking about outlook for Q3 earnings, and the header was revenue growth bottomed out. Can you elaborate on that fact? Has revenue growth, do we see a bottoming out process playing out as far as Q3 earnings are concerned? And if yes, which sectors have seen growth bottoming out?
Sure. Yes, indeed. I think our sense is that revenue growth, which has been very, very weak in the last 5-6 quarters, is bottoming out. The reason for this is twofold. I think firstly, if you see the sectors which started playing up from last quarter itself, these are largely export-driven sectors. So your IT, pharma, ready-made garments, etc., started doing well. However, most of the domestic sectors still did not perform. We see some spreading of the growth now beyond the export-driven sectors. Obviously, it will still not go to the core sectors and infra sectors, but some of the consumption-driven sectors like two-wheelers, media, organized retail, where we see some improvement coming in. However, the other issue is also the base effect. If you see historically till, say, up to FY12, the revenue growth was typically around 16 to 18%, but we saw over the 13-14, the first few quarters and last few quarters of FY13, the growth had very sharply decelerated from 16 to 18% to about 4%. Last quarter we saw the revenue growth came back to about 7 to 8%. What we are expecting for Q3 is overall the growth will still be about 8%. However, it will be little more widespread compared to only restricted to export driven sectors.
Okay, let's talk about an interesting bit. You are predicting that construction sector revenue growth is seen at around 3%. Can you elaborate on that? Within the construction space, which are the sub-segments which will see a revival of sorts? And do we see a profitability also improving, or do you think the growth will only be seen on the top line? For the construction space, the bottom line still is a big overhang?
Yes, absolutely. I think construction sector, actually, we are not expecting any growth at all. Most of the projects execution is still very slow, while there is some optimism which is coming in after some initiatives on the policy side that the government has taken. On the ground, execution is very slow, whether it is corporate infrastructure spend or roads or power sector. So we don't expect revenue to pick up. And absolutely right on the bottom line, in fact, because the growth is so tepid, we expect margins to further contract for construction sector.
Okay. But generally speaking, when it comes to the cyclical space, by when do you see a revival, a full-blown revival? Do you think the outlook is still not clear, or do you think maybe another two quarters that we might see a visible pickup as far as the cyclical space is concerned?
Yes, I think, as I said, the base effect is going to be providing some support for these cyclical sectors. So if you look at, say, cement or steel or construction, clearly the last 5-6 quarters have been terrible. So that effect will start coming in. However, really whether we will see a big positive jump will depend on what happens on political and policy side, because without that playing out, investment cycle will not start. There are a couple of positives in terms of, say, interest rates. We definitely expect them to start coming down from FY15. Inflation is going to be under control, again largely to the base, due to the base effect. So there are some signs on the horizon, but we don't expect a full-blown revival before FY15. So another two quarters at least, growth will remain muted.
Right. Prasad, the segments which have done well over the last 2-3 years now have been the consumption-oriented plays, FMCG, to a lot of extent. Despite expensive valuations, it's the continual earnings beat which has perhaps led to this momentum continuing. What's the outlook for FMCG sector in Q3? Would earnings be able to justify the valuations at which these companies trade at?
Yeah, I mean, you're right. You know, I mean, this is one sector which has performed, you know, in a down cycle. Typically, this is a great defensive play. So volumes growth has kind of sustained, and with rural economy coming back, we expect volume growth to remain reasonably robust. Pricing power was not really there, you know, which was a big constraint. However, we believe that overall revenue growth for FMCG will remain in the about 10 to 12% range. In terms of valuation, yes, I think they appear pricey. And from that sense, if, you know, the upcycle in the cyclical sector starts, the sector actually might underperform.
Okay. When it comes to the rupee impact, you would agree with me that the last 6 months of the calendar year were extremely turbulent.
Yeah.
But towards the end of Q3, the rupee did stabilize a bit. How would you put the rupee depreciation in context to various sectors? For IT firm, right, obviously it's a given that they would stand to benefit, and of course to some export oriented sectors as well. But for domestic sectors which have huge amount of dollar denominated debt, where do you see pain in terms of the rupee depreciation impact?
Yeah, absolutely. I think on the balance sheet side, by and large, the impact is negative. You know, India Inc. has a substantial, and we had put out some research on that, saying that if you look at the total India Inc., we have total about $200 billion of forex debt. And while the exact data on how it has been hedged is not there, we don't believe the entire amount is hedged. So there is, in general, a negative impact. However, you know, beyond pure export-driven sectors, we are seeing some benefit of currency depreciation for other sectors. You take example of steel. You know, I mean, suddenly in the last quarter, we have seen that exports of steel have started going up. You know, this for 15% kind of a depreciation that we have seen has helped them. On the other hand, sectors like energy or cement, which are indirectly depending on imports, or, you know, there is a linkage with the international prices of, say, coal, the impact has been by and large negative. So by and large, I would say that the impact of currency depreciation, barring a few sectors, is negative. However, we see rupee stabilizing. We don't expect rupee to, we expect rupee to kind of be range bound in this 61 to 62 range. And therefore, either the negative side or the benefits on the revenue side for export driven sectors will be much more muted in FY15.
Prasad, how do you see for the banking space asset quality panning out? Do you think this would be another quarter of asset quality disappointment, or we might actually see, if not improvement in overall asset quality, at least the so-called restructuring, the so-called write-offs easing up? Do you think that could be a significant development this quarter, or again that's too difficult to predict yet?
No, our sense is that, you know, the asset quality cycle, while it is close to the bottom, it is not fully at the bottom. We continue to see stress on financial sector asset quality portfolios. Yes, it is indeed, you know, more on the corporate side, on the infra side. But even on the retail side, on, say, for example, commercial vehicle pools, we have started seeing some stress. So we expect this stress to continue. If you look at our rated portfolio as well, you know, where we look at, say, upgrade to downgrade ratio as a, some kind of a proxy on asset quality pressure, there again we see downgrades outnumbering upgrades for another few quarters. So I think the asset quality pressure cycle is not fully played out, but I think the extent of sharp fall that you have seen is kind of getting little muted now.
And how would you look at the metal sector, both ferrous and non-ferrous? Are we looking at any improvement as far as both these sub-segments are concerned? How would the quarter be?
Yeah, I think if you look at steel sector, you know, demand growth has been really, really weak. We are seeing some signs of pickup there on the domestic side. And as I said, you know, some sort of exports have also started. So for steel, we definitely see some improvement. However, on the other side, both for steel as well as non-ferrous, for example, aluminium, we are seeing cost pressures have been significant. So from a margin perspective, we really don't expect, you know, significant benefit to come in.
You know, it's a pretty significant number of sectors that you've actually tracked. And I'm going to try and pick a couple of more before I let you go. On the pharma space, big pharma and mid-cap pharma. Sure. You know, there's been a lot of buying interest in the mid-cap pharma space of late. I know you would not want to talk about specific companies, but do you think mid-cap pharma could surprise us with good earnings this quarter? Because for large-cap pharma, the price to earnings levels have gone up and they are not really cheap in most respects, whether it's PE or whatever metric you want to take up. Would mid-cap pharma bring the next leg of growth?
Yeah, I think so. I think, you know, if you look at even mid-cap pharma in terms of, say, export revenues, clearly that the large-cap pharma has been leading that side. With almost 60% revenues coming from export. But if you look at incrementally in terms of ANDA filings or you know, the regulatory filings that Indian companies have done, you are seeing clearly a widening of the base in terms of number of players who are targeting these export markets. Some of those benefits are going to start coming in over the next few quarters. So exports will definitely be better for mid-cap pharma. On the domestic front, however, as you are aware, you know, there was some changes in the domestic DPCO which was incorporated, and therefore there has been some pressure on the pricing. There was also issue with the trade channel because of the issues or the changes that were proposed in the commission. So on the domestic side, we don't think that, you know, the performance is going to be very good, at least for you know, this quarter or next few months. But things have been sorted out. So from next quarter, we expect even domestic market, which is a much more critical market for mid-cap pharma companies, will start doing well. So from that sense, I think, you know, from next one or two quarters, you will see overall performance of mid-cap pharma improving.
Okay. And just one final sector before I let you go, Prasad, is the power space. And I'm talking about the generation sector. How do you see the sector performing as far as earnings are concerned? And secondly, the developments that we are witnessing right now, whether it's Delhi with the Aam Aadmi Party calling for tariff cuts and bringing in subsidy regime back, or whether it's Mumbai, which I think has already announced a tariff cut of 15%. There was a call about tariff cuts in Haryana, and in various other parts of the country, calls for tariff cuts have started to come back, because I think the restructuring process for SEBs that lasted for about 3 years is now finally beginning to yield some benefit. And on top of that, we have this subsidy issue coming back to haunt the sector. So do you think if there is a revival, that revival might be short-lived as far as the generation sector is concerned, or do you think subsidy issue may not have a major bearing on the sector and its outlook?
No, you are absolutely right. I think, you know, we had started seeing some improvement in the sector with the fuel issues kind of getting sorted out, the FSAs getting signed. You know, some progress on the tariff issue and SEB. So almost all the key issues, we were seeing some progress. So our expectation was that, you know, the worst seems to be behind and things will start looking up from FY15. But what has happened on clearly on the tariff side and, you know, in Delhi, it puts a question mark how it will play out. As you rightly said, even other states are looking at how they can, you know, get into this entire tariff issue. And that puts a big question mark on how the future of this sector will work out. You know, we believe that it will be very difficult to sustain tariff cuts. Cost of energy has gone up, cost of fuel has gone up. While there might be some scope for efficiency improvement, I think across the board cut in tariff is not warranted. The other issue is on the demand side. You know, I mean, while capacity has been coming on stream, you know, on a regular basis, the demand because of slowdown in the economy has been very weak. So if you look at the demand for energy, it was just about 3-4%, and therefore both the peak deficit and energy deficit had declined. What we see therefore is that, you know, as the improvement in demand starts, as economy revives, if the tariff issue is, you know, is not as widespread as, you know, the current concern is, the sector will definitely look better than what it is in the shape today.
All right, Prasad, thank you so much for joining us, and great getting that comprehensive analysis from you. Thank you so much for joining us and with all that perspective as far as how to look at Q3 earnings are concerned, which kickstart from Friday with Infosys and IndusInd Bank revealing their numbers. Let's do a quick check of what's happening as far as Europe is concerned, and a flattish start as far as European markets. Spanish market is just about 1/10 higher. FTSE 100 is flat, and CAC 40 is also flat at this point of time. But looking forward to the week, this will